Welcome to Catching the Light, your daily Bible study. Join us as we discuss God's unchanging truth and show how it can be applied in our day-to-day lives. And now, here's your host, Kip Bradford, on Catching the Light.
Hi, and welcome to Catching the Light. This is episode number 20, I believe, and we are just now starting Acts chapter 9, and I'm looking forward to getting into that. Here in the studio, we have Gia Igarta, who is our resident director of operations and plan giving officer in the works, and you are studying to learn more and more about that incredible job and difficult job to help advise people on their planned giving arrangements, aren't you?
I am studying, and it's complex, and it's a responsibility that is not to be taken lightly. That's one thing that I'm definitely discovering.
Well, I'm glad you're doing it, because I struggle to make sure that the check is written correctly. So, I could never have been a lawyer.
I can tell you.
That's not me. There's certain things that you don't want to put me in charge of. And one is to the highly detailed work. I'm a good overall picture guy. I'm not a real great, that little I isn't dotted correctly. So anyway, Rebecca, what's going on in your life?
Oh, all sorts of odds and ends of things. We're talking about organization, and somebody just asked me the other day, commented that it seemed that my husband and I both had the skill of organization, and then proceeded to ask if we would help with organizing an event. And I said, well, listen, our skills of organization, mine particularly, that's limited to objects, not people. So you need to find somebody else. But I enjoy organizing things, but not people.
Well, you know when someone's complimenting you that it's usually followed up by a request.
Yes. So.
Often, yes.
I was expecting something of the sort.
Well, anyway, it is a joy to work with other people, though.
It is.
I had somebody ask me, sometimes. I had somebody ask me the other day, say, because I love people. You all know that. And somebody told me, he said, how can you stand it? But I find joy in the diversity. And there are some people that annoy me. But for the most part, even if they're kind of annoying, for the most part, I just find something humorous in it. You know? But God, Jesus came to save all men and women. God says, I desire that all men, and he's talking about humanity, be saved. Mm-hmm. How can we have any less of a response to humanity than he had, mm-hmm. as we might think, oh, I don't want to deal with this person, which happens. And then we need to have right in the back of our mind, already predetermined, to say, but this person is God's creature too.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus loves them. I was preaching last weekend, and I said, how many of you have been gone along the road and just looked at a stranger, a homeless person, and thinking, Jesus loves them as much as they love you? And some people raised their hand. I said, how many of you have ever looked at a guy that drove up in a $70,000 or $100,000 Tesla, and they got out and they have it all together, and had the same response that you would have to the homeless person? Jesus loves them as much as he loves me. We tend to look at a certain segment of society and have compassion, but we have to have the same level of compassion to all humanity, be the affluent, mm-hmm. the homeless, the annoying, those who want to take advantage, and those who are slackers,
Yep.
So anyway, Alistair's coming home. We're excited about that.
Yes.
And we want to know what word Alistair has given us today, which is not Blinkenspiel.
No, not blinkered.
Blinkered. No. That's
maybe that was your last episode.
Blinkenspiel.
This time around, our word is hypnopedia.
Hypnopedia.
Pedia.
Okay, so we're familiar with hypnosis, which is not a good thing, but we are familiar with it. And we are familiar with the cyclopedia, so I'm going to say it is the history of hypnosis.
No.
Well, Kip, pede often refers to feet as well. So I'm going to guess that this has something to do with feet.
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 Well, in a way,
It's where your feet take you once you're hypnotized?
We could say it would be a feat, but a F-E-A-T, to be good at hypnopedia, which actually means sleep learning. So wouldn't it be awesome to just go to sleep, turn on your favorite audio of, you know, scriptures or whatever, and by morning, whatever it is that it played, you know.
Can that really happen?
That'd be delightful.
Well, I don't know. It's a concept that came up in the, I think, 1920s, and it's still probably a controversial and a very debatable thing, but that's our word for the day.
I have a habit because my mind won't shut off, much like my mouth. And
they're connected, I think.
They are connected. And so I put a Bluetooth headphone in my ear when I go to sleep, and I bring up Audioverse, which has got just hundreds of good sermons from good dynamic speakers. And I listen to that till I fall asleep. So I tell everybody, and I always fall asleep before the end of the sermon, so I tell everybody I know half the truth. So, but anyway, I've been doing this for a long time. I don't think I'm at all any smarter.
So you're practicing hypnopedic, or what would be the
hypnopedia?
Or I don't, anyway.
Hypno.
I'll ask Alistair to. Yeah,
hypnohypocrisy. So.
All right. We're next nine.
Let's continue. We're starting nine. Let's continue. Let's actually start nine and exquantulate from this topic.
Yes.
Okay. But perhaps we should start with prayer.
Oh, yes, we should. Boy, I was just really wanting to move on, wasn't I? Rebecca, you brought it up, so you get to do it.
All right. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for laughter. And thank you for this time that we can spend diving into your word. Please send your spirit to enlighten our minds and to help us understand as we look closer into the stories that you have placed here for us to learn from. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Now, what you'll remember is from the last episode is we talked about the eunuch and how Philip was sent, and he immediately went and he helped explain the scriptures of Isaiah 53. There was a baptism. Philip, really cool, disappears, and the eunuch is like, where'd he go? And he went off to evangelize his world, because what was the eunuch after that? He was a believer. He was a disciple. His job now as a believer and a disciple is to make more disciples.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's what we left, and now we're starting verse 1 in chapter 9.
Acts chapter 9, starting in verse 1. Then Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked letters from him to the synagogues of Damascus, so that if he found any who were of the way, whether men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. As he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly a light shone around him from heaven.
Wow, we see Saul, before he had his conversion, he is bent on finding people who he believed were wrong, who he believed were needed to be rounded up, and he is actually asking other religious leaders to help him round these people up, and he believed he was in the right, didn't he? I mean, he certainly, we sometimes realize when we're not quite where we ought to be, but he wasn't in that position. He was absolutely sure that he was doing the Lord's will, I think.
Yeah, typically when we do wrong, we know it.
Yeah.
But I don't believe, was Paul a wicked man?
No. He was possibly not enlightened on that particular.
You think so?
The spirit wasn't closely heard. You know, if he was, we don't know where his heart was exactly at in terms of how close to the Lord, but he thought he was correct on this issue.
Mm-hmm. We can be 100% wrong and believe in our heart that we are 100% right.
Yes.
And I believe Paul, or Saul at this point, was in that category. I don't know that, you know, you mentioned a few episodes ago that while he was holding the coat, you wondered if he was thinking, is this right? We have no way to know that. However, if Saul, his heart was intending to do right, even though he was 100% wrong, there must have been a wedge there somewhere down deep that the Lord could get to, because obviously a little later we're going to see that he does, and he does very quickly. Because Paul, I believe, in his upbringing, in his education, in his value system, wanted to do right, and he just wasn't doing it.
You know, I think back to my education classes in college and how my advisor said multiple times, she's like, always make sure when a child does something wrong to ask them the reason that they did it. She said, because a child will oftentimes do something wrong for the right reasons. And what they do is wrong, but their motive is correct, or at least innocent. And so oftentimes we forget that there is that difference as we look at people's behavior. So Saul, what he did was not right. What he was planning was not right. But his motive, we learn from other writings of his when he was explaining himself a little more, his motive was that he honestly thought that he was doing what would bring God the greatest honor and glory.
Sure. And then later in, I think it's in Acts 17, where Paul is talking to this group of folks that had a plaque or a statue or something dedicated to the unknown God. Mm-hmm. And he says, it's in the King James Version, I think, uses the word, and for a time God winked, mm-hmm. essentially at their ignorance.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not going to do that anymore, it goes on to say. Mm-hmm. And I've used that quote incorrectly in the past before I fully understood what it was saying, because I go, oh, well, God winks at our ignorance. He doesn't anymore, because we have every reason to know who God is. He has supplied us with everything that we need to know.
We don't mind if a kindergartner doesn't know calculus. You know, that doesn't surprise us, and we don't expect them to understand calculus.
I kind of insist on it, but
for kindergarten? Okay. You're not teaching any kindergartners that I have any say over. But we expect that by the time they reach a certain level in their education, that they can at least do algebra, you know? And so that's along the same lines.
I can't do algebra.
Let's carry on. So
yes.
The light shone around him from heaven. That was in verse 3. Verse 4 says, then he fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he said, who are you, Lord? Then the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. It is hard for you to kick against the goads. So he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what do you want me to do? Then the Lord said to him, arise and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do.
Jesus, who's contacting Saul at this point, and he's on his road to Damascus, it doesn't say he's on a horse. We've seen pictures that show that he's falling off a horse, and then now stories say that he fell off a horse. It doesn't say he was on a horse. In fact, horses weren't real common for the Jewish folks to ride back then. So likely he was not on a horse. I think that, where's Jesus right now?
He's in heaven.
He is in heaven. Was Jesus being persecuted? Jesus said, why are you persecuting me? We think of persecuting as a physical thing.
His followers were being persecuted, and
okay.
He felt very bonded, you know, to his followers. And It was as though when you're persecuting someone's employee or children, you're literally persecuting them.
Okay.
As he says elsewhere, what you've done to the least of these, my brethren, you've done to me.
Correct.
That is true. There, I think there's a significant thing that we can talk about here in just a minute. But we're going to go to a break, and then we're going to come back and talk a little bit more about what this means, persecuting Jesus as he persecuted the saints. We'll be back right after this.
Thank you for listening to Catching the Light. We pray you're being blessed and encourage you to contact us with your questions and comments. You can reach us by email at radio@betterlifetv.tv. That's radio@betterlifetv.tv. Or visit us at betterlifetv.tv/catchingthelight. That's betterlifetv.tv/catchingthelight. Or simply call us at 541-474-3089. It's our sincere desire that you'll be blessed while studying the Word of God with us here on Catching the Light. Catching the Light is listener supported. To become a financial partner, visit our website
or write to us at P.O. Box 766, Grants Pass, Oregon 97528. That's P.O. Box 766, Grants Pass, Oregon 97528.
Hi, and welcome back to this episode of Catching the Light. If you would like to contact us, give us a word of encouragement, ask us a question, whatever you'd like to say to us, you can text us at 541-508-7409 or email us at radio at betterlifetv.tv or snail mail us at P.O. Box 766, Grants Pass, Oregon 97528, and find us on Facebook. And you can talk to us there on Messenger, I guess. I don't like Messenger. Every time somebody messengers me on my little iPhone, I can't figure out how to read the message. So anyway, we were talking about Jesus had you know, shown himself to Paul, Saul. Or Saul, and he fell down. He, of course, we know he's blind at this point. And Jesus said something very significant. He says, "Why are you persecuting me?" Mm-hmm. Now, later, when Saul becomes Paul, Paul uses this terminology a lot of times to describe the believers of Christ. And how does he describe them? As?
The body of Christ.
As the body of Christ. That is so significant. Here in where is this? Colossians 1, 17 through 18. "And he is before all things, and in him all things exist, and he is the head of the body, the church." The church, we discussed in our common way of speaking, we get up and we brush our teeth and we comb our hair on Sabbath morning, and hopefully we take a shower and have a little breakfast, and then we go to
church.
We go to church. We, in fact, I talked to someone the other day and they said, "Well, I'm not a church going man." We more often think of church as the building that we go worship,
the place
in, as a place. Mm-hmm. But who were you when you woke up this morning is a better word. Not what did you do Sabbath morning, I got ready for church, but who were you when you woke up on Wednesday? Mm-hmm. Answer the question. Who were you?
Part of the church.
We are the church.
Yep.
And so when the church is being persecuted and Jesus is the body of the church.
Well, he's
right?
The head.
He's the head, but we are the body of Christ. Yeah. That's what I'm trying to say.
So he's part of this.
We are the body of Christ. Yeah. So if we are being persecuted, who's being persecuted?
He is.
So even though he was in heaven, his people were being persecuted, and he took that pretty personal, right?
He did. And you know, that's such an encouragement to me that God takes what Satan does against his people, whatever form that takes. Here, it was through the form of Saul persecuting, but it might be something else. But God takes that personally. And to me, that's just beautiful, that the Lord loves you and me enough that he'll take it personally when Satan tries to attack us.
Yeah, and that's beautiful. Now, in verse 5, Paul says what?
Who are you, Lord?
Who are you, Lord? That word, and I may slaughter it because it's not an English word, is kodios. And it means sir or master. And when I first looked it up to see, you know, what kind of Lord is he talking about, it is a term of respect. But it's also a term that was consistently used in reference to the Messiah. When the angel came to Mary and to Joseph, the word Lord was this word. Over and over again, this word is in reference to the Messiah. In a small way, you may say that Paul was already at that moment acknowledging, maybe not understanding this was Jesus talking to him, but understood this was divinity talking to him. Mm-hmm. I think that's significant.
I think so too, especially for then the Lord's answer. Because then he says, "I am Jesus." And so here's Saul realizing that this being that's appearing to him, or this voice, sorry, that's speaking to him is divine, and then to hear that it's Jesus.
And then you get down to verse 6. "So he, trembling and astonished, said," and he says the same word that he said before he was introduced to Jesus. Hmm. He said, "Lord," the same master or sir, "what do you want me to do?"
Yeah, trembling and astonished, I think, would have to be understatements there.
And I want to go back to 5. I actually don't know the answer to this question at all, but I don't know what it means here to say, "It is hard for you to kick against the goads." Can someone enlighten me?
back in that time, and in some cultures, they still use a similar technology, you might say.
Yeah, pointy stick.
Yeah, it's a
that's real technological.
Yeah. Method. There we go. They still use this method of prodding the oxen. And to keep them going straight, sometimes on the plows, they would have somebody walking alongside with sharp sticks to keep the cows from going off this way or that way. They would run into the pointed stick.
Which was a goad.
Which was a goad.
So you kick against the pointed stick. That doesn't feel good, too.
No. And you also we also have the saying, someone was goaded into something. They were prodded. They were, there was some very pointed reason why they did what they did or said what they said. And that's where it comes from.
Verse 7.
And the men who journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no one. Then Saul arose from the ground, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no one. But they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus, and he was 3 days without sight and neither ate nor drank.
This really impresses me as a moment of in Saul's humility or humiliation. You know, here he was very maybe arrogantly or ignorantly self-justified in his position. He thought he was correct. He had garnered lots of maybe support in going after these people who he was trying to get.
And he had letters from the high priest.
There you go. So I'm sure he was seen as a man of influence. He was seen as someone, I mean, we know he was very well educated. He had a certain position of status. And here he is on this road. He hears the Lord's voice. Nobody else who is with him hears it. But the next thing they see is he is probably flat on the ground on his face. And when he gets up, he can't see anything. And so he's being led by the hand by his assistants or by his entourage. And what a moment of silent reckoning for him, where he just thinks, wow, I've been wrong. And now he's blind and he's not even able to eat or drink because he's just needing to process this event.
One thing that I think is really interesting here in verse 9, and it says, and he was 3 days without sight and neither ate nor drank. The number 3 comes up in Scripture over and over and over and over and over. Over 400 times the number 3 is spoken of in Scripture. Now, I don't put too much stock in, what is it, numerology? Is that what they call it?
Yep.
However, there are numbers that are significant. Mm-hmm. And we know Jonah was in the belly of the whale or the fish for 3 days. Jesus was in the belly of the ground for 3 days. In fact, Jesus said, in the same way, I'm going to be also in the grave. I don't know if there's anything to this thought. However, Paul was there for 3 days. Jonah was there for 3 days. What was Jonah doing for 3 days sitting in a stinky old fish belly?
Repenting, I think.
All you can do is be prayer. Repenting, thinking, praying.
We have his prayer that we can look at. In his prayer of despair, someday we'll know this, but I can't imagine that Paul, in his blind state for 3 days, that's significant, that he also went through a time of evaluation, a time to consider the things that he had done and consider the things that God was telling him now as he waited for who to come and baptize him. Let's continue.
In verse 10, so Acts 9, verse 10, now there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias, and to him the Lord said in a vision, Ananias, and he said, here I am, Lord. So the Lord said to him, arise and go to the street called Straight, and inquire at the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus, for behold, he is praying. And in a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him so that he might receive his sight.
Poor Ananias. You know, here he is, probably hearing that Saul is on his way to Damascus, trying to figure out, Lord, what would you have me to do? Do I need to go somewhere else to protect my family? Is this going to be, you know, the end of my witness for you? what's going to happen? And the Lord says, Ananias. And he says, here I am. And it's completely different from what he's expecting the Lord to say. I don't know what he was really expecting the Lord to say. But the Lord tells him to go and meet with the person who was, as it says in the very first verse of the chapter, breathing threats and murder against the disciples. You know, Ananias knew exactly who this was. And if I were in his shoes, I would have had a really hard time with that. But this also shows to me the power of prayer, because Saul of Tarsus is praying. And his prayers, God, because of his prayers, God could then move on one of his people to do the unthinkable, to do something that went against all human understanding, to go and help the person who wanted to kill you. That's not something that we normally would do.
It's not. Let's continue with the next verse.
Verse 13. Then Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much harm he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priests to bind all who call on your name. But the Lord said to him, go, for he is a chosen vessel of mine to bear my name before Gentiles, kings, and the children of Israel. For I will show him how many things he must suffer for my name's sake.
Now, in the last chapter, we talked about Philip. He got up and went. Mm-hmm. See, there's nothing wrong with asking God a question. Could you clarify that?
That's right.
Did I hear you right? Would the name start with an A, or with a S? I guess it was Ananias was the A. With an S, was that really Saul? You said there's nothing wrong with having a conversation with God.
Right.
There's everything wrong with refusing to do what God asked you to do. Mm-hmm. And we, as sinful human beings, tend to do that. So let's go ahead through 17.
And Ananias went his way and entered the house, and laying his hands on him, he said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you came, has sent me that you may receive your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Immediately there fell from his eyes something like scales, and he received his sight at once, and he arose and was baptized. So when he had received food, he was strengthened. Then Saul spent some days with the disciples at Damascus.
I think in closing, we just want to talk about this one thing. What did Saul do once Ananias laid hands on him?
He was baptized.
That is so significant that we need to, as followers of Jesus Christ, take that public declaration of our allegiance to him. Go into that watery grave. It is symbolic of dying with Christ. Come out a new creature in him as Saul, who now becomes Paul. His life was a reflection of that total transformation that you and I have a privilege to have as well, in as we are in Jesus Christ. Thanks for joining us here on Catching the Light. We'll see you next time. God bless.